Vienna, autumn 1964. Vienna, home of Mozart, Haydn, Beethoven, Schubert, Brahms, Johann Strauss, Hugo Wolf, Mahler, Schoenberg. Vienna, a city which still has music in its bones, a place where your taxi driver may well have an opera score in his pocket, and even the chocolate boxes have Mozart on the label. A city of ballrooms, of course, too, like the Sophienzaal. In carnival time, a place dedicated to high pleasure. Most of the rest of the year, it's transformed into a recording studio. And it's here that an international gramophone company is carrying out one of the most ambitious recording projects ever attempted, the putting onto record of Wagner's tremendous cycle of music dramas, The Ring, 17 massive stereophonic hours of music. They began in 1958 with Rheingold. 4 years later came Siegfried. Both recordings won praise from the critics and big international awards. 1964 was the year of Götterdämmerung, the twilight of the gods. Half the opera was recorded back in May. And now, in November, the performers are assembling again, and they're preparing for the final sessions, 10 hectic days which we watched with film and television cameras to tell the story of what goes on when they make the Golden Ring. The man in charge of the project is John Culshaw. I asked him how long the preparations had taken.
About 2 years, I would say. Right from the very inception, right from the beginning, when one has permission to do it, it takes about 2 years.
And what does the work involve, this 2 years?
Well, thinking a lot about which artists to have, and then, of course, the business people have to engage them, and then there's an enormous amount of technical preparation, thinking about the work and the music and what the composer wanted.
What's your major preoccupation now that the recording is just about to begin?
Well, it's really to make quite sure that we do the best by Wagner, to try and recreate in sound, just in this medium alone, just so far as we can, what he wanted, what he meant.
Georg Solti, musical director of Covent Garden and conductor of this entire project of Wagner. He's one of the most dynamic and widely sought after conductors in the world, just flown in from a holiday in Switzerland. The engineers had to lay out over 20 microphones, each positioned to the exact inch. This is the boom with the singers' mics. Gordon Parry, one of the senior engineers. With him is Alberto, the Italian T-boy of the recording team. The first session is tomorrow at 3:00. And they'll be rigging and testing most of the night.
Red, go to earth.
Cold Jimmy to Brown, earth. The other engineer.
Hot to earth, Jimmy.
Yes, that's there.
Cold to earth.
Not yet. No, nothing yet at all.
Hot to yes. Cold.
Solti immediately sinks himself into the problems of the recording schedule. He has an incredible memory for detail.
We had that horn business before that, before the terzet starting.
There's
yes. No horn. We haven't got.
No.
Haven't got yet.
No, that we.
So have to. There's also a remake.
No, I think we ought to listen
actually
to that.
Actually, we start.
No, it's not. It's nowhere near as bad as we thought it was.
Really?
Nowhere near as bad.
Really?
So I think that.
Okay.
That could.
Be nice because this is time spending.
That's on the yes. On the luxury list, I think.
So it is not more than the luxury
no.
List, really.
It's luxury list.
All right.
The singers arrive from all over Europe. They stay at the best hotels, these modern troubadours, the Bristol, the Imperial, and the Zarka, and between recording sessions, they live like rich invalids, pampered and cocooned against the dreaded sore throat.
It's white to earth, Gordon.
The recording team has a flat above the studio.
Uh-huh.
No, nothing.
How now?
Well, it's just sort of moving a bit.
Birgit Nilsson, the Swedish soprano, the finest Brunhilde in the world today. Like the other singers, she's arrived a day early. It takes time for a voice to get used to a new climate. And so, while Vienna goes about its daily business, the stage is set, musically at any rate, for the reenactment of one of the world's great dramas, The Twilight of the Gods.
Yeah.
Inside the control room, they can watch the conductor on closed-circuit television. Solti rehearses for half an hour at the beginning of every session with the orchestra alone. It's the Vienna Philharmonic. They aim to record anything up to 15 minutes in a day in one continuous take, so all the details must be sorted out in advance.
Hat sogar hingeschrieben, wild. Haben Sie es drin?
Ja, ja.
Also, eins. Ich kriege nicht den Krach raus, weil Sie zu spät sind. Eins, ipa, das ist zu spät. Eins, zwei, di, da, da. Die erste Synkope ist zu spät. Bitte nochmal, 60.
The singers join for a trial take, sometimes two, which will be played back during the interval. Before they start, there's a final check over the position and the settings of different microphones, last-minute changes of position for the singers on the stage. It's almost as complex as the countdown at a launching pad.
What are you doing, Gordon?
Hello. Okay, fine. Okay, on stage. Yeah, Christopher, do remind Wolfgang that we need his cue at the beginning of this. With full voice, with, yeah. Kenny Watt? Yeah.
Further back in that case.
Yes, okay, fine.
Schweigisch die Klage.
Yeah, right.
Okay.
Hello. Yes, hello.
He's worried about 47. Do you need that?
Yes, we do. We do need it for cutting. So if you'll start three before 47, that's all right. Okay, so it's three before 47. He's still talking.
Right.
Take 158. Light. Siegfried left, Jimmy. Left.
Schweig, Wolfgang. Schweig ist die Klage.
Cutting. Yeah?
And then Hagen center.
Es zählt von wem?
Yeah. Don't worry if you don't get him right at the beginning. It's only cutting's four bars later. Hagen Center. Not too much. Not too much.
The part of Hagen, the evil genius, is sung by Gottlob Frick. Here's Wolfgang Windgassen singing the part of the hero, Siegfried. In Act Two, where Siegfried betrays Brunhilde. And now here's Nilsson, in action, singing Brunhilde's passionate counterattack. At first glance, Vienna seems to have very little to do with Wagner. Wagner's music is German music, German Kunst. Vienna is less heavy, more sophisticated, more Mozartian. The spirit of the city is in the old houses around the Cathedral of St. Stephen's, the streets where Mozart lived and died. And heaven knows what Mozart, or Beethoven for that matter, would have made of Götterdämmerung, although Wagner admired both these composers. In fact, Wagner was no stranger to Vienna. In the 1860s, he often stayed here at the Imperial Hotel, which is where Solti is staying today. Solti told me why they decided to record the Ring in Vienna.
Here is an orchestra, which is the Vienna Philharmonic, which is, in my mind, produced the most beautiful Wagnerian sound which you find anywhere in the world. So it's very logical. When you have that huge work recording the Ring, you must bring it to Vienna, where the orchestra is here, when you can produce, in my mind, the best possible Wagnerian sound.
The best possible Wagnerian sound. And one of the most striking things about the approach to the recording is the attention to the details of Wagner's wishes.
John?
Yes?
Am I right in saying the D flat is on the left and the D is on the right?
These steer horns, for example. In Act Two, when Hagen summons up his followers, Wagner wrote parts for three of these old instruments. One in C on the stage, a second replying with D-flat offstage left, a third with the note D answering offstage right. Nowadays, the parts are always played by trombones in the orchestra pit, which ruins the effect. Here, in a separate hall, the Blue Ballroom, linked by television with the main studio, the musicians and engineers are rehearsing the proper effect of distance and sound quality. The hall has a much more reverberant acoustic. They had to have the steer horns made specially. The original instruments were pinched from Bayreuth by American soldiers after the war.
A big one?
No, no, the sharp.
No.
Do you think they're... No. I still think they're a bit too far away.
I do, yes.
They just haven't got the points in the press.
Well, just, shall we bring them in?
Visibly.
But we're going to get more of a from them if we
no,
do.
No, I think a bit of that is from this limiter that's not balanced.
Well,
I think if we come in about a...
Well,
it's going to
do it. Bring them in about a
meter.
But he's got to move.
Well, it's easier to move the mics.
So we're going to change position, Christopher. Tell him to hold it for just a minute.
After lunch, the orchestra assemble at the Sophiensaal. The Vienna Philharmonic is at full strength, including the special Wagner tubas which the composer invented himself, over 110 players in all. Today's session includes the tricky steer horn sequence, and Solti arrives well in advance for a final check. When they're using the Blue Ballroom as well as the main studio, the police are tipped off and traffic is diverted from outside the building. It only costs a couple of bottles of cognac a session.
Okay, go ahead.
The take begins at the moment when Hagen summons his vassals to the banks of the Rhine, the steer horn scene.
John, may I ask you, stop if you have a disaster with a steer horn, stop me, because it's too tiring to do it so many times, so rather stop me. Right? Because I have no headphones, so I don't hear them.
No, but I'm listening here.
Right.
Fischer, Fischer, können Sie mich hören im blauen Saal? Fischer.
Steerhorn in D off stage came in early. Schultz is asking Herr Fischer, the assistant conductor in the blue ballroom, to give the steerhorns a clear beat by watching on the television monitor.
Herr Fischer, hören Sie mich?
Fischer can't answer back.
Keine Antwort geben. Gut. Achten Sie auf die D, Stierhörner. Ich höre, dass Sie zwei Takte zu früh kamen. Die Stimme ist sicher nicht falsch. Ist nur versaut worden. Achtung bitte.
The problem is something that will soon sort itself out. After a couple of takes, they break for tea and listen to the tests. The question at the moment is whether they've succeeded in making the steer horns appear to come nearer and nearer the stage.
Achtung blauer Saal, Achtung blauer Saal, Achtung blauer Saal, Achtung, Rubitte.
Ready?
Ja. All right, John, let's do it. So, meine Herrschaften, das ist das Gleiche.
Take 130.
John, do we have now the balance, the beginning, the bass?
Fine, fine.
Very good.
Excellent, excellent.
Hören Sie? Here we are.
Here's the final recording as it actually happened. This is the point where the steer horns should start coming nearer.
Out, flower, flower. Now start the chorus, help them up.
Outside, it's dark by 6 o'clock, And if you wander back into the recording studio, there's an uncanny feeling of stillness after so much tremendous activity. Solti was working in his hotel room when I asked him what he felt to be the biggest problem about preparing such an enormously long opera.
The biggest problem, I think, and this is not only for my recording, for everybody's recording, is that you get a daily pensum. You get 12 to 13 to 14, in very lucky case, 15 minutes, which you have to do. There is no chance whatsoever to repeat that 15 minutes another time, because it's before me here, the schedule from Götterdämmerung, we put it about into 25 sessions, music which is goes to 275 minutes.
Nearly 5 hours.
Nearly, more than 4.5 hours. Little more than 4.5 hours. Now, if you lose one session, you just lost that. You can probably remake a minute or 2 minutes of it, but you cannot remake 40 minutes. So the big problem which everybody facing by that kind of huge working, or opera recording, that you has to do your daily pensum as well as possible. So a fight, a daily fight for that your pensum. So that is the first. The second is that you must think very special in this kind of work, not only on your daily pensum, but what you did yesterday and what you will do tomorrow. In other words, if you do like the immolation scene, which is about a half an hour, which you cannot do in one, you must do in two parts. All the tempi must be related to the yesterday or the tomorrow session. So you cannot just work for today. You must know exactly the conception of the work and what you want. Now, thirdly, and I think that is an essential question, you must not be stubborn. You must be, by recording very flexibly in that way, you make a test, which you think probably you put everything new musical conception into the test, and then you hear it. And you must not be vain and must not be stubborn and stupid, because you must then hear that what really you did and immediately try to take the consequences of that set, which means tempi, balance, expression, everything. And again, the trouble is you haven't got the time to play it twice or three times, then make clearly. You cannot. You just hear it once under a rather very hectic condition. I think you saw it many times. Everybody is listening to that, rushing in and out, and you talk to the singers, talk to the producer, and still, you must make markings all the time. I have a very special style to that. My first marking are red pencil, and the second hearing are blue pencil, so that I don't mix up the things. And you can see my, like a French impressionistic painting is looking, my score full of any kind of colors. Anyway, essential, quick, change your mind. You know exactly what is wrong on that tape and try to put it right.
Solti also has to rehearse with the individual singers, of course, to make sure that they agree about the interpretation. There's a piano rehearsal every morning about 11 o'clock.
Begin very, very soft,
and
the second
are
a little bit stronger.
And the third one, and Mickey, that's fine.
Yeah.
But beside of
I know
beauty,
what you mean.
Yeah. Transcendent quality, yeah. Which is some very far away. She's no more here.
Right.
That
yeah.
I see she
is
lost.
Keep them working.
Roll, Jack.
The recording team always spends an hour or two checking the takes from the previous day. I broke in on them this morning to find out how it all worked.
Can I interrupt just a minute or a second?
Sure. Okay, cut it, Jack, cut it.
First of all, I mean, John, you've got your score and you've prepared, obviously, in advance.
Yes.
And then what are Jimmy and Gordon doing?
I have 12 microphones on the orchestra. We're orchestral manager. I'm responsible for the orchestral balance internally.
12 microphones? Awful lot, isn't it?
No. Pop work, they're often up to 20 or even more. But for this particular opera, I consider 12 is adequate.
And Jimmy, over there?
Well, I've got 3 stage microphones for this particular piece.
and three Blauer-Sal microphones. And
each of those things under your finger is a microphone?
Yes, I'm not using them all at the moment. I've got three on the stage, three in the Blauer-Sal for this echo effect, and two corridors for off-stage horns.
And John, are you making sort of changes in intensity every bar almost?
No, not in every bar, but all these effects have got to be controlled, I mean, as the composer wanted. And so I have to give cues to Gordon on the one side for the orchestra and Jimmy on the other side for all these effects as they come in just before and so on. But it's all planned beforehand, right, left and centre and whatnot, as it is with the artists and so on.
And Jack, I know, is outside during the tape usually. And Christopher's job as stereo man, what does he actually have to do?
Well, he works closely with me before we record to plan all the movements and so on for the artists. And then he's the sort of go-between between the studio and here. He's also responsible for seeing on the stage that the artists carry out the movements properly, because of course we have to work blind in here, we can't see what they're doing.
Is there anything else like this, John, anywhere else in the world?
I don't think so. Certainly I've never heard of one that's as versatile as this, let's put it that way. I
mean, who designed it?
Jimmy and myself.
It's fantastically versatile. Fantastic, isn't it?
We've cut now to 5 to 6 that night, just before the end of another 3-hour session. The scene they're working on is the fierce argument that breaks out when Brunhilde accuses Siegfried of being unfaithful.
Light, right. Siegfried in, half left, Brunhilde centre. But this isn't a remake for him, it's for her.
This scene introduces us to 5 of the principal singers in turn. But if one tries to describe the relationships in detail, one soon gets into Anna Russell territory.
False start.
We got enough tape.
Yes, we'll get along.
Standing on the right of the stage is the chorus master, Wilhelm Pitz, well known over here for his work with the New Philharmonia Chorus. He's brought over to Vienna especially for the recordings. The voice of Fischer-Dieskau singing Gunther.
Danke, sir.
Another 10 minutes or so in the bag. And one has to keep reminding oneself, as Solti did, of the enormous scale of the operation. 4.5 hours broken down into 25 sessions. And with 5 days left, they still have 73 minutes of music to record, including many of the greatest pages of the opera.
Morgen drei.
One bout of flu could ruin the schedule and the budget. Solti there with Willy Boskowski, leader of the Vienna Philharmonic. This whole process of recording is still criticized by some musicians who reckon that by chopping the music up into convenient portions, you end up with an accurate recording, but rather a dead performance. I asked John Culshaw about this.
If you chop an opera up into 3 or 4 minute sections, I believe it was done at one time by some people, then of course it's impossible. You lose all the continuity, but doing it in this sort of what we call long take, sometimes 15, 16 minutes, I don't think the architecture suffers at all, especially as we seem to be doing, working on an act at a time, more or less.
But it does require an enormous imaginative effort on the part of the singers, doesn't it?
Oh, yes, it does. This method, yes, it imposes a much greater strain on them. Much, much greater, but a better result, I'm convinced.
I asked Birgit Nilsson the obvious question of how the recording studio compared with the opera house.
It's very difficult, you know, in the opera house, the public inspires you and you are dressed up, you're made up and you do the whole role, you know, continuing. Here you have to make over and over again and have the same intensity all the time. And without public and with many things who bothers you, conductor very far away, and so it's very difficult.
Sessions are not easy either for the orchestral players. The solo horn player, Roland Berger, talked about the difficulty.
It's quite different to say this. If you play sessions, of course, you don't get this influence of a performance as a player, but you can do much more, you can risk much more in a session, and therefore the result of the orchestra, of the performance, will be much better.
This is the Musikverein, home of the Vienna Philharmonic. And since the orchestra plays such a crucial role in this recording, it's worth considering their very special setup. Founded in 1842, they give only 10 programs a year. The rest of the time, they play in the Opera House Orchestra, from which, if you're lucky, you're elected to membership of the Vienna Philharmonic. It's a self-governing organization with an immense respect for tradition. The committee pick their guest conductors with great care, always have done. And their portrait gallery contains pretty well all the big figures of the past 100 years. Among them, taken at random, Klemperer, Sir Adrian Bolt, and of course Gustav Mahler. As we've already heard, their Wagner playing has a unique sound quality, which I asked Maestro Solti to define.
Yes, this is a difficult question. What is the speciality about that? First of all, question of a brass playing. They have that typical Viennese school brass playing, broad sound, the brass hasn't got the sharpness from an American, or even the flexibility like an English-American orchestra, the brass player could produce. They are not so flexible, probably, but they have that very broad building of the sound, the trombones, the trumpets, and the horns as well, which is fit wonderfully into the Wagner sound. So that is the main feature, we put it. But beside of that, the combination of the very sweet string sound which they produce, one can even say that probably too sweet. But that two elements, two ingredients, produce, in my mind, this wonderful mixture of Wagner, lush and broad sound.
Und von jetzt sehr deutlich spielen, das da. Jetzt auch. Es braucht ein kolossales Appassionato hier. Was könnten wir machen? Man hört überhaupt natürlich nichts von ihm. Wollen wir versuchen einmal teilen?
Saturday morning rehearsal, tomorrow morning
Eric Smith and Christopher Rayburn have supervised recordings all over Europe, but this is about the most complex thing they've ever worked on.
It'll only be for Birgit, if anybody. Put for Birgit here.
Yes, question mark.
Fine. All right, session Saturday. What's the date? Yes.
Hey, what are these, scream tracks?
Oh, well, they're wild tracks we're going to take after the end to see, like the fight in Tristan, you know, either it may or may not work. It didn't in that.
Who's going to...
Siegfried on his death, Gutruna when she sees the body, and Hagen, well, at the end of the whole shoot.
So everybody screams except for Brunhilde, didn't
they? Yes, no screaming in this one, yeah.
All right, now, Saturday session.
1500, 3 o'clock.
15, right.
Brunhilde. Hagen, if he's here, not beetled off to Germany.
Does he threaten to?
Yes, possibility. Right. Six harps again.
You have checked that, by the way, in the score.
Yes.
The daily schedule is a kind of blueprint for the various activities which are pressing forward pretty well simultaneously.
All right, we cut on the same place as before, Jay.
All right. Not quite so easy, this one.
Coming up.
Tape editing. John Culshaw is picking out for Jack Law a possible alternative take of a passage from the Steerhorn scene. Using the three or four different takes made during the session, the aim is to edit together a version which captures the drama of the situation as well as the music.
Oh, yes, quite
here. Really? I thought it was rather a beast.
You've given me worse ones, John.
All right. I expect there'll be worse to come before we finish. Just a question of whether he's at the same level, I suppose, on the two of them.
Yeah, sounded the same. But,
sounds the same.
Yes. Never can tell. Might be Yorkster, I suppose.
Well, if it works, we shall get the in-tune Steerhorns for once.
They'll be spending weeks intercutting between the different tapes in search of the best assembly. This master tape is then transferred to the gramophone matrix back in London, and then the discs are manufactured for selling in the shops. You'll see the tape join going through.
Well, I hope you have a second choice.
Well, if we have to. Say a prayer. Here we go. That's perfect.
Right, absolutely perfect.
Bravo. Good. Splendid, Jack. Right. Good. Well, the next one's quite a long way on, actually, so you can spool on a bit if you like, yes. Yeah, well, there was something wrong with the voice quality, but I don't think it's worth worrying about. Let's go on, make it as a test, and then hear it.
You don't think we should
do it? I don't think it's worth it, because I think it tires Birgit. We'll have to do it again.
Jack Law, the tape editor, is an enthusiast for other things besides Wagner. We caught him talking about trams.
You see some blue trams about...
Yeah, that's the Interurban, which goes to Baden. That's,
That must be a very long one of the longest tram routes there is, isn't it?
Where the Baden?
To Baden?
Hmm. Well, it's long if you call it a tram route. It's an interurban. It's not a tramway. It's not a town tramway. It's an interurban. That is, it goes between one town and another. Right. But it behaves as a tram when it's in town.
How many kilometres is there?
To Baden, I should say about 30. I'm guessing, but I should say about 30.
They always said the longest tram route in Europe was from Marseille to Aix-en-Provence.
But is this a tram or a railway?
It's gone, of course.
It's gone.
And now we've moved on to the next day's recording, to a short scene in Act One, where Gutruna greets Siegfried for the first time. The singer is the American soprano Claire Watson. There was a wrong entry somewhere, so they need to do this beautifully tranquil scene again, and Solti is taking the chance to ask Claire Watson to make a particular portamento effect at the top of her phrase. breaking his stick in the process.
Fast ein portamento. Ja, viel mehr legato, liebes, viel mehr. Dann machen wir es doch mal. Schwer das hier so nachträglich.
Take 152.
Dann machen wir es schnell noch mal.
With Katrina is her brother Gunther Fischer-Dieskau.
Das Ende, wo bevor ein Takt vor der Dreiviertel, seien so nett und kommen Sie bis zu fortissimo rauf. Das ist das schöne, espressivo molto. Join by the three quarter, John, by the woodwind entrance.
Yeah,
you cannot. All right. So, 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 schleim. Machen wir es nochmal. Es war sehr gut. Das war jetzt. Sehr. No light.
Psst. Okay. Take 153.
Gerade schönste Stärstag, wir müssen es drauf kriegen zum Teufel.
The tea break, coffee break one should call it, because the musicians drink these small black coffees all the time. I talked about Wagner to Fischer-Dieskau. I knew he'd not sung Gunther before, and I wonder whether he felt in sympathy with the world of Wagner.
Because there are so many problems around him, and it's a bit difficult to separate his purely artistic qualities and his human weaknesses.
He did have human weaknesses.
Yes, of course he had.
But people still go and hear the music, I mean, all over the world, the Wagner music.
They want to hear it. I think it shall be for a long time.
But can you put your finger on why it is that they're so attracted to the music itself?
Because he is a sorcerer, in a way. I was in love with him already when I was a boy of 9 years old.
What do you think of the Wagnerian philosophy, the idea of redemption through love and this atmosphere of the twilight of the gods and the collapse of the world? Now, do you think this kind of thing has any relevance to us now?
I don't think that's the most important part of Wagner's work today. I think the substantial musical material in the work is the most important. And his art of presentation.
But what about the story? What do you get from it yourself?
Mainly the family tragedy which is in it.
Like
it's a most, and the human passions you find in the ring.
Almost like a Greek tragedy. Important. It's almost like a Greek tragedy, I suppose.
Yes, I think this was his idea, to renew this on a new ground, of course.
How do you see your own part of Gunther?
It's a kind of a German Macbeth, in a way, because he doesn't have his lady, but he has Hagen, his half-brother, and he leads him, and he has to do everything what he wants.
He's evil, you think, Gunther?
He's evil, yes. Yeah. He's a weak character, of course.
But if I may say so, you make him sound rather noble.
He has to be noble, he's a king.
Here's the playback of the same passage. They're not very happy with it yet. The sequence they're working on is the Vengeance Trio at the end of Act Two, the scene where Hagen and Gunther conspire with Brunhilde to kill Siegfried, even though Gunther and Siegfried have sworn an oath of blood brotherhood. Solti wants them to emphasize the rhythm of the music. He's famous for bringing out the electricity. The singers are more concerned with making themselves heard through the orchestra.
Das ist so schön, ja? Ach, das ist so schön.
Ja, ja, das haben Sie gern.
Ja, ich hab's gern. Das ist so schön.
The Blood Brotherhood theme is hammered out by the horns, and after the playback discussions, Solti rehearses it again with the orchestra, still insisting on the rhythm.
Nicht kurz markieren, tenuto, pa, 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 singende. Kann ich das Des, nur die Des-Geschichte spielen, Des. So etwas. Können wir zusammenspielen, das wäre etwa. Wir haben Doppelstrich hier, ja? Nach 66 das erste Doppelstrich. Kann ich beginnen? Bitte hier. Also das sollte enorm sein, diese Hornstelle, absolut enorm. Eins, zwei. Ja.
And now here's the final take of this tremendous Vengeance trio.
Hey! Marvellous. I mean, you'll never get a sound like that in an opera house, and it's an enormous brass.
No, I quite agree.
Nor even in a concert hall with any equivalent piece. Well, you said you were at the festival, well, that's for sure.
No, I quite agree. Maybe in the Musikverein here, but of course it's no good for recording.
No, I think Sophienzahl is more brilliant, really.
Yes.
They often have some sort of a party in the recording team's flat. It helps to break the tension.
It comes from Frankfurt. It lands at Frankfurt. As the plane comes down the runway, so they switch off all the lights behind it. And so all the customs people putting their coats on and getting ready to go home.
You mustn't tell.
Oh, wonderful.
Yeah.
No,
it
doesn't help.
I'm
just trying. Oh, let me have it.
I said you can turn out high C's like nobody else.
Well, I said you should save them for us.
We do, for the future.
For the future.
Well, we don't know how many high C's we've had to cut into other artists.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Better save them to have some.
We sell them, you see.
Oh! Do I get royalty on them?
I'll bet you we don't tell you.
Where is the royalty on my high C's?
At the Opera House on the same night, they're doing Rosenkavalier. Billy Boskowski again, the concertmaster. They keep two complete sets of violins for all the players. There's another stack of instruments like the one behind him back at the recording studios. Most of the players will have already done a 3-hour Götterdämmerung session before coming on to the Opera House, although they've enough key players on call to split the acts of a long opera between different soloists, an unheard of luxury in London. In a moment, Richard Strauss's opera will begin. But for those responsible for the Götterdämmerung recording, even for people like myself who are only lookers on, it's impossible, even at night, to get Wagner out of your mind. The whole business of recording involves living at a quite unnatural intensity.
Well, I don't sleep very well, or not at all sometimes, very little. Either using sleeping pills or not, it's not a question. And you get rid of the certain passages only possible that the next morning you turn the next page and try very hardly study that. It is like a picture taking. By that one, you come to the next picture into your mind, and of course you hammer that one into your mind, but never really get rid of it. You cannot get rid of music in a music hearing. That is, of course, the price just to be paid for very intensive working. But I don't mind.
This is Siegfried's death scene. Slain by Hagen, the hero bids farewell to the world and farewell to Brunhilde. and before Siegfried's solemn funeral march has got underway, Wolfgang Windgassen is speeding to the Westbahnhof to catch the night train to Germany. His recording stint is over. He has a performance of Fidelio in Stuttgart next day. Farewell to Siegfried. There's a school of thought that Siegfried's nobility is sham, that the philosophy behind Wagner's drama of the Ring of the Nibelung is totalitarian, fascist. Hitler loved it. I put this criticism to Georg Solti.
Oh, I entirely disagree. I think it's entirely wrong. Of course, Hitler misabused that music very much. First because he liked it, and he went to Bayreuth, and every year went and sold something very special on it. But it's not Wagner's fault. I do entirely believe they are great musical masterpieces and nothing to do with any totalitarian fascism philosophy at all. At least I don't see it. I do think that The Ring is a unique masterpiece. Relation, a musical expression of a theater and a drama. It is something only, I think it's only once happened in the human history, in the last century.
Thank you.
Kurze Pause. Zigarettenpause, ja?
That was Siegfried's funeral march. The tempo gave them a lot of trouble. In an earlier take, Solti took it more slowly, but Culshaw persuaded him to try it a touch faster.
The whole
conception now is...
I'm afraid they're getting now too fast, and then I will kill you. If it ends too fast, John, I never talk to you.
Kill you if it's too
slow? Never talk to you in my life anymore.
All right, well, I promise you
then you are guilty.
No, I promise you the tempo is right. No.
Right.
All right, we have... All right.
As a...
2,000
shillings.
2,000 shillings.
If it is too fast.
Okay, it's not too fast.
That's all right.
But what it's got now is a line over it instead of being...
Yes, but still, it shouldn't be fast. I mean, those could be somehow bridged over, probably.
Right. Now, going start from the beginning. The horn sound is good now, and you've got them together. So
it is all right.
It's an extraordinary feeling when you leave Siegfried's funeral march and go outside to the ordinary world of Vienna. You've grown accustomed to the Wagnerian intensity, the Wagnerian time scale. When you walk out in the morning, you want to go up to these people and say, don't you realize what's happening? Don't you see that a great drama is taking place on your doorstep, something which transcends everyday life, something which everybody should hear? And then you're caught up once again by the recording schedule, and we arrive at the final day's sessions, the ultimate climax of the opera, when Brunhilde rides into the funeral pyre and Valhalla goes up in flames. Nilsson is recording the first test balance. Scene, Brunhilde is about to call for her horse Grana and urge it into the flames as a final gesture of sacrifice. The recording team thought that at the end of this great epic, it might be a good gag to produce a real horse. Nilsson knows nothing about it. And now, 2 hours later, here's the final take of the immolation scene and the end of Götterdämmerung. Thank you. Here, then, are what somebody once called the high priests of flawlessness. Men who love Wagner, men who love music, men who are not afraid to harness machines to the endless search for perfection. Men and musicians coming now to the end of an epic chapter in their recording of The Golden Ring.